Hello. We've got a great show lined up tonight, including a very special guest. I'll be talking live to the most powerful spin doctor of the last 50 years, the man who put Nixon, Reagan and Trump in the White House, Roger Stone, who's coming up later on, plus all the usual bollocks.
It's Saturday night. It's almost live, and it's right up a big tower in London's Westminster. It's Sam Delaney's news thing. Struggling with the NHS winter crisis this week, clinging to his GP's ankle and begging for morphine, it's Tez Ilyas. Languishing in a coma under a broken-down ambulance, it's Janey Godley. Self-medicating inside a hospital bin, it's Nigel Evans, MP. And craftily flogging off a syphilis clinic to Richard Branson, it's David Mills. Plus, he's the lobbyist and strategist who helped Donald Trump get elected and is the master of political tricks dirtier than Charlie Sheen's DVD collection. It's Roger Stone.
Hello and welcome to Sam Delaney's News Thing. Thanks for joining me, panel. It's been a triumphant week for Theresa May as her far-reaching radical reshuffle transformed her cabinet. Here it is before the reshuffle, and here it is afterwards. So diverse, it makes a Southall minicab company look like the Bullingdon Club. To be fair to May, she wanted to do more, but successive cabinet ministers refused to budge. Justine Greening resigned as education secretary rather than be moved to work and pensions. And Jeremy Hunt refused to leave the health ministry for a job as business secretary. Now, why would he do that? Being business secretary is the cushiest job in government. Up at 8 for champagne breakfast in Branson's hot air balloon. Then over to Philip Green's yacht for a party at 12. Then at 4, it's coffee with Rupert Murdoch as he persuades you to let him buy out the BBC in return for a personal introduction to ignorant Geordie columnist Carol Malone and a guest role in The Simpsons. Magic. But somehow the mad bastard has actually begged the Prime Minister in tears to stay in the most thankless job in the country. I mean, running the NHS must be a fucking nightmare, whoever you are. Whatever part you're from, however much money you spend on it, everyone hates you and calls you a murderer every winter. It's basically impossible for the country to keep up with the ever-increasing demands on NHS resources. Well, you know, unless we make corporations and the super-rich pay their fair share of taxes, of course, but let's be serious. Rather than doing what most of us would do, curl up under a duvet and watch Button Moon reruns until the next election, Jeremy Hunt has turned down the greatest job in Britain to stay in the worst. And not only that, he asked to be given the extra role of governing social care. Who gets offered a plum job smoozing the rich and famous and instead asks if they can take on responsibility for cleaning every pensioner's arse in the UK? The bloke is either stupid, mad or both, which I suppose makes him the ideal candidate to run our health service. Still, at least he fucking believes in what he's doing. Don't worry, I'm not defending Jeremy Hunt, but I am saying he's sincere in his bizarre dedication to find a solution to the health service problem. I mean, he won't, but he's trying, so well done, I guess. Panel, should we just bin the NHS off and give everyone in the country 50 quid and a packet of Beechams and let them look after themselves?
Absolutely not. I mean, in Scotland, we don't have the same problems. Our NHS outperformed the English NHS. But we didn't have Jeremy Hunt being trolled by Ralph Little every day. So we did a whole lot better on that.
Nigel Evans, if you ignore an illness, it usually goes away, right? So shouldn't that be the message that our overstretched NHS are putting out there, especially during winter?
Well, they do say, don't they, now and again, that doctors bury their mistakes and it doesn't always go away, sadly. I have to say, though, I did keep my phone off so that I was not contactable until the NHS job had gone.
Yeah.
As it appeared, I really didn't need to keep my phone off because I didn't get anything.
You didn't get any messages.
No.
In the 80s, they used to say, oh, the punishment job, the job that Thatcher used to give to the ministers she disliked the most was Northern Ireland, right? Because it was dangerous.
Yeah, it was very dangerous.
Now, I think the equivalent's the NHS, isn't it? Because you can't win in the NHS, really.
It's totally thankless. As you said right at the beginning, there are problems. The NHS is actually run by different people in England, Wales and Scotland, and they've all got problems. All of them have got problems. So,
but not as much.
In Scotland, he's better.
Well, there's more money going into it in Scotland, funnily enough, per head of the population. But the fact is, everybody has got problems with running the health service.
Just lastly, Nigel, the reshuffle in general was a disaster. It doesn't reflect well on Theresa May's authority, does it?
It didn't start very well, did it? Although I have to say that Chris Grayling was the most successful chairman we've ever had of the Conservative Party.
Yeah.
27 seconds.
Yeah.
Did any Scottish Tories get a place?
I don't know.
They didn't, is the answer.
Yeah. It wasn't very... They wanted to make it more diverse. They felt that they were falling out of touch and everyone saw it as an old, white, decrepit
Did
kind of cabinet.
Did you see the picture?
And she was going to shake it up.
Right.
Tez, do you think that people from diverse ethnic backgrounds and different age groups across the country will look at this new cabinet and think, wow, breath of fresh air?
No, I think they look at it as the same stale, old, crusty thing it was before. Mm. I mean, Sajid Javid is the only person of an ethnic background in the cabinet and he kept his job. Added housing to the title, and that's about it. But otherwise, it looks exactly the same, boring and stale.
Thanks, panel. Look. And now it's time for our new feature.
Shut up. Britain is speaking.
Yes, this is our new weekly roundup of below-the-line comments on the biggest news sites about the biggest news stories of the week, expressed by ordinary, everyday, ill-informed and unnecessarily angry people like you and everyone you know. This week, Waitrose had to remove Sequela Italian coffee from its shelves after an appalled customer claimed the tins showed black slaves hauling beans while a white plantation owner looks on. But it's nothing more than a storm in a coffee cup, according to Concerned of Plymouth.
It's a picture from 1856, for goodness sake. How do you know this man isn't working on his own farm and the European man has come to buy his coffee?
Good point, Mr. C. Meanwhile, Let's Sort It Out from Sheffield had this to say.
If this is offensive, how come the film industry can make full-length movies about the subject?
Let's leave the final word on this story to Anne from Sheffield. Anne?
So easy to wipe out history, but poor old Kevin Spacey is not allowed to.
Very true, Anne from Sheffield. It seems there's one rule for pictures celebrating slavery and another for men recently accused of sexual assaults. I think I'll stick to a nice cup of tea. Over in the USA, Elizabeth Hurley posted an Instagram video of her in a bikini, showing that at 52, she's still very much in the pink. And viewing the video on the Daily Mail website, it became clear she wasn't the only one enjoying herself.
Beautiful white woman.
Oh! Johnny D echoing the thoughts of many there. And what's that you want to add, Ivor?
I'd love to give her hours of pleasure.
Oh!
Very kind. But not everyone was so pleased to see the radiant Miss Hurley. Judas Iscariot got in touch to say,
I don't do women over 30.
Well, let's move on from one tasty dish to another. Our old pals at M&S have been mocked for selling what they call cauliflower steaks. A slice of cauliflower in plastic packaging for £2.50. How did that go down with Mr. Watson of London?
The word steak should be reserved for steak.
Elementary, my dear Mr. Watson. Make mine medium rare. But there's a more serious point, according to Leave Means Leave.
What's worse is it's probably been chopped up by an illegal.
Very, very good point. Let's leave the final word on the subject to Celeb P on Yahoo News.
I keep thinking Muslim related, probably not, but that's what springs to mind.
What?
Food, you mean cauliflowers?
Food for thought, quite literally. Now, it's the book that everyone's been talking about. Well, not me, I don't read books. They're for boffins and ladies. But if I was going to read a book, which I'm not, it would be this one. Michael Wolff's Fire and Fury, an inside look at Trump's first year in the White House. So, who better to tell us what's in the book than someone who says he's read it? And what's more, he's a real-life American, so I hope he doesn't shoot me with a gun. It's David Mills. Hello, David.
Sam Delaney, how are you?
I'm OK. So, David, you read books, do you?
Occasionally, yes, I do.
What do you think about this book, Fire and Fury?
Hilarious. I loved every second of it. It's a real romp, you know what I mean? Full of palace intrigue and great detail. I loved the whole story about Melania weeping on election night because she had no interest in being first lady. In fact, no one on the Trump team thought they were going to win.
David, are there any exciting twists or murders in this book?
Well, I wouldn't say it's a twist, but it's something not detailed but alluded to, and that's that you've never actually seen Melania Trump and Caitlyn Jenner in the same room.
Right. Good point. Is there anything about Oprah Winfrey?
No, but of course she's in the news because everyone's speculating that she's a potential Democrat candidate to take on Donald Trump. I think this is exactly the wrong idea. The last thing we need is another untested celebrity in the White House. Sam, what we need is someone who's familiar with the Oval Office, who is familiar with national leadership, who has the trust of the country, and it would be great in a crisis. This is why I'm backing Morgan Freeman.
Just lastly, David, as a reader of books, as you claim, what is the best book?
On the Road, but not the Jack Kerouac version, the Ollie Murs biography.
Yeah, I've heard good things about that. David, for now, thank you.
Thank you, Sam.
Panel, have any of you read this book or have you just skimmed all the headlines in the paper like me? Tess?
Me, I loved On the Road by Ollie Murs.
Yeah.
I thought it was a fascinating read and a real insight into the A-list lifestyle.
Everyone keeps telling me this. Nigel, if Melania was in tears on election night, how upset do you think she gets on erection night? That was a joke.
You mentioned Oprah Winfrey earlier on, and as you know, Donald has just pulled out of his visit to the United Kingdom for all sorts of reasons. Not happy about the embassy, apparently. Only cost £1 billion, and he thought they gave the old one away for peanuts. But maybe we can invite Oprah to open the embassy.
That would be a fantastic idea, wouldn't it?
Absolutely brilliant.
But it wouldn't go very well. It wouldn't go down very well with your for your government, would it? For your leader?
No, it would have been really nice had he come across, not just simply to cut the ribbon outside the embassy, but clearly there are things to talk about with us leaving the European Union. We want that trade deal. At least we're at the front of the queue for the trade deal, and like with Barack Obama, who took all the trouble to come across to the United Kingdom and tell us we'd be at the back of a trade queue. That was nice, wasn't it?
Janey, he was scared of you, wasn't he? Because you scared him before when he's been over with your legendary
Trumpism
slogan.
A piece of lino and a bingo pen. I'm an enemy of the state. Mm. And he's petrified, and I wanted him to come over to Britain. I don't believe that we should tell him not to, because then we just become him. Make him come over here, because I've got a new pen and a bigger bit of lino.
Yes, and do you have a new slogan, or it'll be the same slogan?
But oh, no, bigger. Trump is a cunt. There isn't anything.
Why gild the lily? Why gild the lily? thanks, panel. After the break, we'll be asking one of the most influential men in America how he put Donald Trump in the White House. Mr. Roger Stone coming up right here.
I consider it a work of fiction, and I think it's a disgrace that somebody's able to have something, do something like that, where you can say whatever comes to your head. And you look at some of his past books, so much of it was false, okay? It's in his imagination. Honestly, it's very, very bad for our country. It's making our country look foolish. And this is a country that I don't want looking foolish.
Welcome back. Plastic, 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 plastic. Plastic. Plastic cups, plastic chairs, plastic fruit, plastic trains, plastic eggs, plastic rocks, plastic arms if you're an amputee or diabetic and it's all gone wrong. Rubber ducks, which are actually made from plastic. Yes, we all love plastic. I mean, it's called plastic precisely because it rhymes with fantastic. It also rhymes with spastic, which you can't say anymore. That's racist. For the last 150 years, we have been living in the plastic age, and it's been fucking great. Now, they even make sex robots, so you can have sex with plastic, like what you've always wanted to. Yes, the sex might be cold, emotionless, and lacking in any tenderness, but don't worry, soon you'll have a robot to do it with. Seriously, Helen, you could at least move about a bit. But don't get too attached, because Theresa May has just declared a war on plastic, claiming that it's bad for the environment. This is all part of her attempt to win over the youth vote by telling them there'll be some planet left for them by the time we've had our go on it. But it does mean from now on they'll have to eat their pot noodle out of a dog's skull. The pens they write their tedious essays with will be goose feathers. And instead of Twitter, they'll just have to punch strangers. It affects all of us. That slide you keep in the back garden for your kids, that's now made of horrible splintery wood. Your VCR, that's now papier-mâché. Your mobile phone, a useless seashell. Your toothbrush, a twig. You can still use mouthwash, of course, but it'll now be dished out at the supermarket in a metal ladle and you'll have to carry it home in your hands. Of course, we all know who's really behind this, don't we? That's right, Attenborough. Ever since BBC's Blue Planet showed a video of a turtle choking on a Polly Pocket, everyone's been up in arms about the amount of plastic dumped in our oceans. Well, guess what, nature lovers? What do you think your telly's made out of? Just be thankful that we have plastic. Otherwise, we'd still be making our tellies out of ivory and blubber like we used to in the 50s. Anyway, who exactly is David Attenborough? The know-it-all granddad of Britain with a solid gold environmental conscience? Or actually, a TV charlatan with his eye on the main chance who'll say any old shite to cash in on the latest trendy liberal causes? Well, take a look at this outtake from the original edit of Blue Planet and decide for yourselves.
The mother whale holds her deceased offspring to her chest. The cause of death? Excessive plastic consumption. Marine experts calculate that over 4 million fish die each year after consuming plastic waste in our oceans. Yet, the fact remains, if they didn't like it, they wouldn't keep eating it. Some experts claim that the 6.4 million tons of plastics dumped in our oceans every year are necessary to sustain the growing aquatic populations that choose to gorge themselves on our discarded bottles, used condoms, and Star Wars figurines. Without such treats, their diet would be dull indeed, comprising whichever unedifying algae, tasteless plankton, and disgusting prickly crustacean things float their way. Little wonder that so many prefer the more exotic delights of a discarded bottle of Lidl own brand fairy liquid. Some may judge animals such as this young gull, recovering from a 4-day styrofoam and polythene bender, but at least he died doing what he loved.
Tasty plastic. I can't get enough of the stuff. Panel, plastic's the best thing ever, isn't it, Tez?
I love plastic. I think we've gone too far now. The planet's fucked. Mm. Let's just enjoy the good times and then the future can worry about Mad Max times.
Exactly. Let's fucking enjoy the small amount of time we've got left, Janey. I mean, is it right that £400 each year is spent on developing plastic beaks for diseased hens?
That's madness, and I think the plastic has to stop. And you mentioned the sex dolls. I don't understand why they've made sex dolls for women. We just pull off the bit we need. It's not as if he's going to tile the bathroom and have a chat, is it?
No, that's very true. Yeah. Very true. And robots, apparently, according to science, will be running everything by 2050. So why don't we just keep on stockpiling plastic waste and let them sort it out if they're supposedly so clever?
Because Donald Trump would have blown all that up by then, because you know that he's got a special button and he's going to press it. I think they've actually replaced that button, the nuclear button, and when he presses it accidentally, it's just like a confetti cannon goes off.
Oh, yeah, so yeah.
And then we know that he's done it again.
And they're probably just showing footage from a war-torn country and gone, you did it, look what you've done, and he'd be like, yeah, get but my, that.
That would be my, a fantastic
my,
idea.
My favourite toy at home is not one of those plastic dolls, but Alexa.
Oh, yeah.
And I said, Alexa,
yeah.
What are we going to do with all that plastic? And when you play that, it'll now be answering
what's interesting, every Alexa
home.
In the land,
yeah.
In the homes of our
it's
millions
Alexa.
Of viewers,
yes.
It's a robot.
Yeah, and we'll be answering.
It's an Amazon robot, and I've got one too. And you ask it a question, it answers. You tell it, you ask it whether it'll be, it'll tell you. You tell it to play your favourite pop tunes, and it will do it.
Yep. Why am I married to a man?
Yeah, well, precisely.
I mean, I heard a story.
It's actually fairly phallic in shape, in a sense.
The big ones.
Plastic. Yeah.
I heard a story about a guy who came back from a work business trip, and he came back and he switched his Alexa on, and the man who'd been fucking his wife was playing around with it, and he found out his wife was cheating on him. Alexa grassed his wife up.
Well, that be a warning to all adulterous women across the country. Is that Alexa's watching you, and rightly so. Thanks, panel. Time now for my special guest. It's the first show of 2018, and I can tell you that we've already got the best guest ever. We're now joined live from Miami, Florida, by the man who was the brains behind the most unlikely presidential campaign of all time. He even has a Netflix documentary all about him. His name is Roger Stone.
I'm an agent provocateur.
Political strategist.
Controversial as you can get.
An incredible capacity for treachery.
Win at all cost mentality.
When people think of Washington corruption, they think of Roger Stone.
Roger saw something that nobody else saw back in the early 80s.
I suggested that Trump should explore a bid for the presidency.
He created Donald Trump as a political figure.
You're the biggest liar, loser.
What have I lied about?
Have you spoken with the WikiLeaks founder?
You're a rape denier.
Roger, you can't just say that.
You have to be outrageous to get noticed.
America may be collapsing, but Roger Stone is determined to enjoy it.
I revel in your hatred, because if I weren't effective, you wouldn't hate me.
Welcome to News Thing, Mr. Roger Stone. A trailer there for the fantastic Netflix film Get Me Roger Stone. A fair reflection of your career and your personality?
Well, look, I had no control in the matter. There are a few things in there that I would quibble with. Donald Trump is the master of his own fate. He is the person who created his own candidacy. I just helped along the edges.
Roger Stone, in Michael Wolff's new book, it suggests that Donald Trump, the man who you first suggested should run for president, never wanted to be president, even when he was deep into his campaign against Hillary.
No, considering that I spoke to him throughout the campaign, he never evidenced any desire to do anything other than win. And from the beginning to the end, he was entirely confident that he would win. Above all, Donald Trump is a competitor. He would not have run if he didn't want to win. In fact, that was the holdup in 2000, and I think perhaps in 2012, when he was trying to make the shrewd calculation, can I win? Mr. Wolf has a reputation in this country as a fabricator. He's fabricated things that I've said in the past. I wouldn't put a lot of stock in what he writes.
Well, Donald Trump's state visit to us in the UK has been canceled, and a lot of people in the media here suggesting that's because he knows that he will receive a negative reaction from the British public and is concerned the impact that might have on him. What do you think about that?
You know, in politics, we don't guess about things. We use survey research to determine what people think. My guess is that he would be well received by some segments of the British public and not well received by others.
We in Britain, as you know, are quite formal, old-fashioned, conservatively minded people. And most of us find Donald Trump quite ghastly. Can you understand that?
He is controversial, nothing if not controversial. On the other hand, we have a record stock market, unemployment at all-time lows, African-American unemployment at the all-time low, since those statistics have been kept, a boom in the housing market. We have ISIS on the run. So overall, given the two-party duopoly and the elite opposition to the Trump presidency in this country, I think he's doing remarkably well.
Now, Roger, Nixon, Reagan, Trump, you have got the Midas touch with US presidential candidates. Do you think Oprah Winfrey can be president?
Well, in America, theoretically, anybody can be president, but I would argue that she's at her high water mark right now. Now, there was a fairly respected poll here. The Rasmussen poll yesterday released showed her leading the president by 10 points. I don't think anyone thinks that a 10-point lead would hold up through a campaign. She has not been subjected to any of the scrutiny that would come to a campaign. There's been no controversy about her candidacy. It's all been accolades. Would she be competitive? Yes, but first she'll have to face off with Michelle Obama, who I have predicted will be the Democratic nominee in 2020. And that would be a catfight worth seeing.
And what about Theresa May? She has struggled, as you'll know, to get a majority, to lead the country with any authority. Could a man like you do anything to help her right now?
Well, I'm a bit more of a dry. She's a bit wet for me. I would not want to suppose, again, my opinions on British politics without studying some polling.
Do you know much about Jeremy Corbyn, our, you know, fairly radical left-wing opposition leader?
Isn't he a communist?
I think it, perhaps in the lexicon of US politics, probably the answer to that is yes. And lastly, what about Nigel Farage? He seems more like someone who you could work with.
Well, I've shared one dinner with him. I don't know him well. He does have this amazing ability to smoke, eat and talk all at the same time. I don't know that he is candidate material, but he has most certainly had an impact on your politics.
Thanks, Roger. Thanks also to my panel this evening, Nigel Evans, Janey Godley and Tez Ilyas. Before you go, you may have heard John Humphreys was overheard making unguarded comments in the Today studios about the gender pay disparity at the BBC this week. Well, we've dug up a second tape that the BBC are trying to suppress, which we at Newsthing have decided to fearlessly play to you, our viewers, right now. Enjoy and good night.
I fucking told her, she wants money that badly, go and get another job like I do. I mean, I do Mastermind, don't I? Go and get a bar job. I was looking for Bird. Whoops, better out than in. So, yeah. Oh, I'm going to see Jumanji again at the weekend. Fucking love The Rock. Take my own popcorn. I'm not paying the cinema prices. Only fucking popcorn. Hey, not recording this, are you, you twat?